100% sure.
Sorry.
Yes. Yeah. Anyway, so good evening. And I think we talked about the generosity and ethics last time, because I'm using Pema Chodron's commentary on Shantideva as well as the Shantideva book itself as a go-by. And I think what we could talk about tonight would be a little bit, just kind of finish up a little bit about ethics, because he talks quite a bit in one of his chapters about patience. And so, yeah, I think we can just get a start with patience. And because he talks about patience as being the antidote to anger. And so maybe that's a good spot to start. So we'll start there. Okay. All right, here we go. So, short prayer. In the Buddha, his teaching, and the order most excellent, we take refuge until enlightenment is reached. By the merit of generosity and other good deeds, may we attain Buddhahood for the sake of all that lives. In the Buddha, his teaching, and the order most excellent, we take refuge until enlightenment is reached. By the merit of generosity and other good deeds, may we attain Buddhahood for the sake of all that lives. In the Buddha, his teaching, and the order most excellent, we take refuge until enlightenment is reached. Through the merit of generosity and other good deeds, may we attain Buddhahood for the sake of all that lives. I will have to pause, so let's pause. So the book we're working from is the Guide to the Bodhisattva's Way of Life by Shantideva. And I'm using as a helping book, No Time to Lose by Pema Chodron, where she takes on 9 of the 10 chapters of this amazing book and explains them from sort of a modern perspective, talking about the practices and the disciplines of the Bodhisattva. And so I'm going to start with the discussion of patience. And this is chapter 6 of the Guide to the Bodhisattva's Way of Life. Because in some way, Shantideva addresses all 6 of the 6 perfect virtues, which he says are what take this ordinary body of flesh and blood that we have and turn it into the body of a Buddha. It's like the philosopher's stone of the alchemists. Bodhicitta is so powerful. Remember last time we read in chapter 1, like a flash of lightning rends the night. So rarely through the Buddha's power, virtuous thoughts arise, brief and transient in the world. And the very next verse, he says, thus behold the utter frailty of goodness, except for perfect bodhicitta, there is nothing that can withstand the great and overwhelming force of evil. And so he's already established in chapter 1 that bodhicitta is so strong, it can defeat evil. And so he then tells us the rest of chapter 1, just keep grasping bodhicitta, keep grasping. And so that's what we've been taught to do through this book. So the virtues, the 6 perfect virtues, are ways that we can gradually over time begin to wear away the self-clinging and self-fixation that cause so much of our suffering in life. The Buddha basic
He said, suffering is part of life. Suffering has a cause. Suffering, the cause of suffering is not something external. The cause of suffering is internal. It's our own grasping and clinging. And of all the things we grasp and cling to, the thing we cling to the most is our sense of self, me or I. And we often hold that sense of self, that sense of me or I, as being superior to other people. And we can find ourselves doing it all the time, such as when we judge other people by their behavior, when we find ourselves saying, well, that person is bad, and that person is bad, and that person is bad, and so on. In a way, what we're really saying is that we are the judge of them, and that we are actually superior to them. Whenever we find ourselves negatively judging people, we do so because we have this sneaking suspicion that we are superior to them, and we exercise that superiority through judgment. And there are six ways to counteract our own negativity, our own self-grasping. Generosity, we spoke about the last time, is the first. Because if we are grasping all of our wealth and grasping all of our perceived happiness and cutting other people out of that, and then thinking that we are superior, then this causes trouble. So what we have to do then is find a way to be generous, both to ourselves and to others. And so it's my hope that by practicing even simple forms of generosity, such as Kempo Kartha Rinpoche said, very, very early when he was first teaching us, he said, if you really want to practice generosity, practice it first in a way that doesn't hurt you very much. He said, feed animals, feed the birds, put food out for the birds. And then he told us that we could say mantras over the seed and the bird seed and then put it out. He said, the animals don't come up and say thank you for being fed. And so he said, in that way, he said, that's a very easy sort of generosity that you don't have to worry much about. And then he said, from there, you can advance and give more and more until you can finally give things that are important to you. Well, anyway, so this practice of generosity helps us come out of ourselves and go beyond ourselves. That's the first of the perfect virtues. The second of the perfect virtues is ethics and morality. And Kempo Kartha Rinpoche, when he talked about ethics, he talked about it as a form of stability. That if we're generous, it's very easy for us to be ethical, and it's very easy for us to not steal from, cheat, or hurt other beings. And so his idea was that if we are generous and so on, it's very easy for us to act in a stable way with ourselves and with others. He says, when we are aggressive with others and or we hurt others, we become people who are untrustworthy and seen as not being stable and not being trustworthy. But whereas if we act with ethics, then we are more likely to have people trust us. And so just these simple things, generosity and ethics, make us a person others can have confidence in and trust. Well, the next of the perfect virtues there's patience and diligence. And he talks about these in his chapters. Chapter 6 is the chapter about patience. And so he talks about first about the difficulties of anger. In chapter 6, the very first verse talks about, it gives us the word, you might have a problem with anger, and anger might be a problem for you. He says, good works gathered in 1,000 ages, such as deeds of generosity or offerings to the blissful ones, a single flash of anger shatters them. This reminds me of something that the previous Kelda Rinpoche once said to us. He said, he called the anger the atom bomb of karma. He said that even if we have accumulated a great deal of merit, positive karma, even a small moment of anger will wipe it all out. And I think he says, and Pema Chodron in her commentary says, but to emphasize the immensity of this, that anger was destructive, but she said, destroy years of ethical conduct and virtuous actions. And then it says here, we know the familiar scenario of being in a harmonious relationship, then suddenly there's a nasty incident. One minute there's love and friendship, the next minute one of us is out of control. The physical or verbal abuse can wipe out months of goodwill or goodness. And even if we apologize, it takes a long time to rebuild trust. So even a single flash of anger has long-term consequences. And so then, according to some commentaries, this verse goes even further and addresses the anger we don't regret and that we actually justify. We can stubbornly hold on to our anger for lifetimes, like the family feuds and ethnic rivalries that go on for centuries. Pema Chodron says, I know two brothers who live next door to each other, but haven't spoken to each other in 25 years. This is what Shanti Deva talks about, anger that we condone, hold on to, and remain unwilling to examine. Then she says, once we recognize the unnecessary pain our anger causes, we are already on the way to undermining its power and its ability to shatter years of goodwill. That, of course, is precisely what Shanti Davis wants us to understand. And then she goes on and says, you know, we all have parts of ourselves that seem unworkable and cause us grief. As she says, if we're habitually angry, then exploring this can become a major part of awakening bodhicitta for us. And Shanti Deva assumes each of us has the ability to free ourselves from the tyranny of our kleshas. No matter what we have done, none of us is doomed. And I think that that's an important thing for us to keep. And so, the fact that we have, she says, good works that can be so quickly destroyed are superficial, superficial acts of generosity, superficial offerings to the Buddhas, and so on. These are not the good works that transform us at the core. Fortunately, a fundamental change of heart can never be lost. And I think what she's getting at here is that, we may not think we have control over our thoughts, and we may have a lot of habitual thoughts, but we can slowly exercise control over, like, this. We may not be able to control the first moment of anger, the first flash of anger, but through the practice of mindfulness and love and compassion, we might be able to get a hold of the second or the third or the fourth or the 80th or the 100th moment of that anger, and then begin to walk it backwards. And I think that it's that fundamental desire to be able to turn ourselves around, that's the power that we're seeking, the power to recognize that anger is not useful, and then the power to find a way to turn ourselves around. And so Shanti Deva talks about this. And he says in the second verse in chapter 6, he says, no evil is there similar to anger, no austerity to be compared with patience. Steep yourself, therefore, in patience, in all ways, urgently, with zeal. And so he's instantly in the second verse presenting the antidote to anger, which is patience. And what's interesting, the
the fact is that patience may seem like putting up with something and causing ourselves additional pain and suffering by putting up with the evil of others. And but I remember when Lama Lodro Lamo was teaching in Columbus, she was teaching on the six perfect virtues. And one of the things that she said patience is not putting up with something. It's not enduring something.
She said it isn't putting up with something. It is being open to how other people are. Being open to how other people are. In other words, it's being open to understanding the suffering of other people. It's being open to understanding their own inner struggles and how their own inner struggles are like our inner struggles. If we have a thing that makes us impatient, we can easily see how it makes other people impatient. And sometimes that makes us even more impatient because after all, we see that as a weakness in ourselves perhaps, and then we see it as a weakness in them and so forth and so on. And so what we have to do is we have to recognize that patience doesn't mean that we're putting up with something abusive or wrong. We're being open to the pain and suffering of other people and recognizing that this is how people are. And when we get up to the fifth verse in chapter six, he begins to talk about how anger really causes us trouble. From family and friends estranged and shunned by those attracted by their bounty, men of anger have no joy, forsaken by all happiness and peace. Then there's another one. Noble chieftains full of hate will be attacked and slain by even those who look to them for honor and possessions. She says that there are all kinds of abusive people out there. They terrify everyone, even their own children and those who rely on them for food, promotions, well-being. If you've ever been in such relationships, she says, you know that any lack of gratitude for what these people provide outrages them even more because they're so explosive and unpredictable. Even their gestures of friendliness or generosity are seen as untrustworthy. They aren't able to see how their anger destroys trust and respect. Shantideva urges us to see that abusive people have no joy and no peace of mind. They shatter their own happiness by justifying their anger, and the very people they expect to love and honor them have the strongest aversion toward them. And so she says here, the point, however, is not the noble chieftains. The point is to acknowledge our own anger and the way it harms us as much as it harms others. And so then the sixth verse in chapter six, all of these ills are brought about by wrath, our sorrow-bearing enemy. But those who seize and crush their anger will find their joy in this and future lives. And so then she goes on to explain that we have to take a decisive moment and say, this stops here. This anger stops here. This cycle of hurt and anger, it stops here. I am going to stop it right here. And what Shantideva and Pema Chodron are saying is not that we should put up with the abuse of others. I don't think they're saying that at all. They're saying that we have to recognize the triggers for our own anger and find a way to turn them back, to turn them away. And you remember, I think we may have talked about this last time, may not have. We talked a little bit about how ego fixation gets triggered. The word that Ziger Control, Pema Chodron's teacher, uses is the Tibetan word Shenpa, S-H-E-N-P-A. Shenpa literally means to be hooked by something. And we can actually feel Shenpa when something goes against us. We can feel a tension, possibly in our chest, possibly in our jaw, possibly in the back of our head. We can feel this tension. Our eyebrows collide together in the center of our head, and we feel, you know, we feel negatively. And this Shenpa is the activation of our ego fixation. We think we're good. We think we're good. In fact, sometimes we think we're the best. Unless we have the opposite problem when we think we're the best at being the worst, but that's a whole nother kettle of fish or kettle of tofu, shall we say. And so whether we think we're the best or the best at being the worst, it's still something is in us is hooked by the stimulation of our ego fixation. And so she talks about what triggers our anger. When she's talking about this, she says, it's what triggers our anger? Shanti Davis says, it's getting what we don't want and not getting what we desire. When we are heavily invested in our likes and dislikes, tiny reactions can escalate into violence and war. When we're afraid of getting stuck with something we don't want or being deprived of what we need, our thoughts come in as reinforcements and escalate our anger and pain. Full-blown destructive anger starts with subtle Shenpa as an uncomfortable feeling that things aren't going our way. It's helpful to recognize this uneasiness before it escalates into full-blown anger. If, however, we've already gotten angry, then we can still try to find the patience to not act or speak. It's never too late to put an embargo on the fuel of misery, she says. At any point in the process, we can pause and practice patience. Trungpa Rinpoche used to say that when something like anger arises, we should regard it as not me. Just think of it as a little bug trying to land on you. If your mind remains open and free of bias, the bug has nowhere to land. Shantideva, in his own words, is saying the same thing. Anger is not me. It's just dynamic energy. If we don't identify with it, that energy remains unfixated and free. If it freezes into I want or I don't want, however, we can accurately predict the outcome. It will cause us, the basically good us, to suffer. And so this is why in chapter six, verse 9, Shanti Davis says, so come what may, I will never harm my cheerful happiness of mind. Depression never brings me what I want. My virtue will be warped and marred by it. In other words, we recognize the danger that anger poses, and we make a commitment to our mind becoming workable. Pema Chodron talks about workability here, and we discover workability for the first time when we're meditating. We're sitting in meditation and a thought, we're watching the breath and a thought arises, and it might be a really ugly thought, but if we recognize that we're thinking, if we label it thinking, let it go, and then return to the technique of watching the breath, that negative thought disappears. And when it disappears, we have formed a new habit. Instead of feeding our negativity, we choose to let it go. And that choice to let it go is a choice that we can make again and again and again once we've gotten the habit of it. Of course, we have to get into that. We have to get into that habit. And it's not easy because we believe as human beings, we believe in justice. We want justice to be done. We don't want injustice to proliferate. And therefore, we sometimes hide our anger in, we cloak our anger in the clothing of, well, I'm just looking for justice, or I'm just trying to be honest and I just want justice to be done. But what we do is, once we say that, then we are kind of gleeful and excited because now we have a free cover for our anger and we can do what we want. But we've really fooled ourselves into thinking that anger is the right choice. So he then talks about, after having talked about and wished for steadfastness in the face of anger, he talks about the three categories of patience. And this, he starts in the 13th verse in chapter six. He starts talking about three kinds of anger. The first one is the patience. And I said anger, the three kinds of anger. I apologize. He says the three kinds of patience. The first category is the patience that comes from reframing our attitude toward discomfort. The second is the patience that comes from understanding the complexity of any situation. And the third category is the patience that comes from developing tolerance. Remember what Lama Lodro Lamo said, patience is not putting up with something. It's being open to how other people are. It's like, yep, that's them being them. It's like, how can you hate the grass for being green? So the first of these kinds of patience is reframing our attitude toward discomfort. And what happens here is that we really like comfort. I think human beings really like it, and we really dislike discomfort. And so we sort of demonize discomfort so much that we don't want even a tiny bit of discomfort. And here in this society we live in, we're actually able to control a lot of our discomfort and not have as much as people have elsewhere. We can control the temperatures of our homes. We have clean water. We have all kinds of things that other people in the world don't have. And so we can actually have comfort. We have a ready supply of food. We have shelter for the most part, and so on. But the problem is that way, any tiny discomfort is reacted to with anger, and then reacting to that tiny discomfort with anger then causes the habit of not being patient at all with any kind of discomfort. Pema Chodron says we form a low tolerance for discomfort. And then we expect other people to provide us with comfort. And then that unrealistic expectation is disappointed, and guess what? We get angry. So the idea is that we teach ourselves the benefits of putting up with small hardships. And this is really something that that when we were learning about the Great Path of Awakening in the class on the 7-point mind training, where they recast discomfort or hardship as a way of purifying our negativity and purifying our negative karma and accumulating virtue. And so in this way, by practicing patience, we're actually purifying negative karma and accumulating merit. And we're forming new habits too. So if we have the capacity to change how we feel about discomfort, and then can use it as a way of saying, may my discomfort contain the discomfort of all beings. And by my working with this moment of discomfort, may I and all beings be free of discomfort. And may we become Buddhas, the complete freedom from discomfort. That's a powerful way of reframing how we see discomfort. We see it as a way of purification. And the second kind of patience is the patience that comes from understanding the complexity of any situation. And the complexity of any situation means there's more than just our side of the story. We have to see sometimes that people are in conflict with us because they have they have unresolved issues with themselves, and we happen to represent that unresolved issue. So they get angry with us, thinking that they're somehow going to fix. By fixing us, they're going to somehow fix their own tendency to impatience. And so we can look at any situation as not being yes or no, black or white, but we can see it as being subtle, full of subtleties, some of which involve us. A person came to Kempo Karthar Rinpoche once and said, I don't understand why this person is against me. And I don't understand why they just keep picking on me and why they won't let it go. And Rinpoche said, well, you know, I don't know for sure. He said, but it's apparent that this person thinks that you owe them a karmic debt. And he said, when he was teaching about this one time, when he was teaching 7-point mind training, Kempo Rinpoche said, have you ever met somebody who you instantly liked? He said, you probably had a positive karmic connection to them from a previous lifetime. And he said, have you ever met a person you instantly disliked and you didn't even have a reason? He said, once again, it has to do with negative relationships from previous lifetimes. And so he said, obviously, this person doesn't even know why they don't like you. And they may think they know, but they may not know. And it could just be that they're working out some distant karma. And so he said, one of the things you can do is imagine that the person you're in conflict with is in front of you, and mentally create a gift for them. And he says, and what you should put in this gift is everything you have, everything you own, all of your merit, just put it all in that imaginary box and send it through your mind to the person that you're in conflict with. And he said, and do this every day, until you feel different. It's not going to affect the other person at all, but it will affect you. And the subtle changes that this will work in you will actually benefit the other person sort of by long distance. My friends in the 12-step recovery tradition will remember that in the big book of Alcoholics Anonymous, there's an exercise that is called praying for someone for 30 days to have the things that you want, all the good things that you want for yourself. And so I find it really interesting that all sorts of traditions think that gifting, using an imaginary gift, whether it's praying for someone to have something that you have or sending an imaginary gift to help pay a karmic debt from the past, these types of things can be so helpful to our psyche. The subtle nonverbal cues that we give this person that tells them, I don't like you, not one little bit, that some of those will slowly be impacted by this mental gifting. And I once met two women who had been friends since childhood. And as adults, they worked together and so forth and so on. But again, these childhood friends suddenly had a falling out, and they really were angry and disappointed in each other. And interestingly enough, when I visited the city where they lived, each of them came to me individually saying, I don't know what to do. I'm mad at so-and-so. And then the other one said, I don't know what to do. I'm mad at so-and-so. And so I gave them this practice, each of them this practice, and told them to do it for each other. And they didn't know that each had come to me. So I just told them to do the practice. And within about 3 weeks, I heard that they had patched it up. But it was just, I guess you could call it dumb luck that they both asked me and that I was able to tell them both. So, but the idea here is that this has to do with this second kind of patience, which is seeing the complexities of a situation, that situations are not just black or white, that there can be shades of gray.
The third kind of patients that we can work on is the patients that comes from developing tolerance. And once again, this has to do with being open to how other people are, which is what Lama Lodro Lamo says. When we when we have the opportunity to see our own faults in any situation, and to begin to see and have patience with ourselves, then sometimes this will help us have patience with others. Shantideva, in the late parts of chapter six, talk about it's hard when people slander us. This is in verse number 62. He says, if when others slander us, we claim that our anger is because they harm themselves, how is it we do not resent their slander when it's aimed at someone else? So again, we have to find a way to expose our own hidden faults and to see the complexity of a situation and see that if we can handle our own resentments and in positive ways. And again, we can see that the patience that comes from developing tolerance and being open to how other people are, and just say, I see how you are, but it doesn't mean we don't try to help them. It just means that we try not to be angry at the grass for being green. And for a person who's had a really hard go in life, who ends up being angry, we have to come and understand that. In any case, I don't want to go on too long because I've already gone on longer than I meant to, and I only covered patience and I didn't cover diligence. So what we'll do next time is we'll start with diligence and talk about joyous effort. And for those of you who are looking to read about that, joyous effort and enthusiasm, this is talked about in chapter 7. So in any case, that's something to think about. So we'll talk about that next time. Yeah, and it could be that the good news is that I can't really teach chapter 9, which is about wisdom. I can't really teach the wisdom chapter. I don't know how, but I can talk about wisdom in general terms. And so we'll talk about diligence next time, and then a little bit about meditation and a little bit about wisdom. And so that way we will have covered some of the main points that Shantideva makes in his book. So discuss, shall we? Shall we discuss patience? Where we've been able to have it? Everybody has things that where they're really able to be patient with some things, but there's some things that people cannot have patience with that just isn't possible. And we all know which those are for us. For me, it's anybody telling me to my face that I'm stupid. That's really hard for me. I just have a hard time with that. I can't accept it. But the fact of the matter is, sometimes I really am stupid. Anyhow, we don't have to turn this into a confessional, but if anybody wants to talk about patience or if you have questions, feel free to unmute and have a chat.
I can share something that happens, and it actually happened today. And okay. What you say is really hitting home. And that's somebody I work with. He has like this pattern where things go well for 3 or 4 weeks, and then he'll find one thing that I do and he'll blow up and he'll be gone for 2 days. And then I'm like, all right, so I offered to help with a project. He got really angry and he left. And my first reaction is, just thinking about it, then I go through the anger of it all. Seriously, he's going to get pissed and leave and be angry. And it's like, I go through this and it's happened over the year, every 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks. This time we made it 5 weeks. I thought we're almost into the home stretch. And if I could just bring my mind around to how you say, you know, how you've said, well, let's look at them. Let's look at their anger, something they're hurting, maybe not taking it so personally each time, but I do. I take it so personally. So, you know, how do you deal with, I don't know how to deal with the fact that I feel dumb. I feel stupid that I haven't learned already to just take that step back and be like, enough already, you know?
Well, right. And this is a person you cannot avoid working with, right?
No.
See? So, right. All right. Yeah. Well, right. And I think you've got a good insight into it because you've seen the pattern, right?
Yes.
You've seen the pattern, you know, it's coming and you can't avoid working with them, right? You can't go to a superior and say, hey, this is how it's going. Okay. So yeah, if you're in the situation and can't escape,
right,
then it really then does become like, okay, so what are they going to do this time? You know? So, I mean, right.
Right.
And I have known people in the past who've been like this, actually. And you just kind of, for me, the hard part is that they walk away. I have a person in my life who does that. And now that I think about it, I have one too. And kind of, I just have to say, you know, they're hurting so bad and they just can't. They can't carry through on something, and it's easier for them to make it your fault.
Right. Yes.
And right. Instead of actually just doing what needs to be done because they feel inadequate or they feel right. incapable. And so they throw that at you. But as long as your superiors are aware of the situation and the people who are directing your projects know that the situation is there, you can just say, well, here we go again. But I would try the gifting Tonglen, the Tonglen in difficult situations.
Yeah.
And the other thing is you can really imagine him as being 2 years old and throwing himself on the floor.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes this helps. I don't know if you watch late night television, but Stephen Colbert has been doing a routine lately where he does not, where there's an irritating politician, and he used to imitate the irritating politician. He doesn't do that anymore. He has a 7-year-old child read that person's words. And that's how he handles it, by imagining this terrible person as a child throwing himself on the floor. And that helps him to not take it personally and not, I mean, because it's actually not about you. If you were a different person, this guy would still do the same thing.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Because Kim Prokhorovich, you know what he said one time? He said, look, he says, if you've got a problem with one person, it could be that person, could be down to them. He said, but if you got a problem with that person and you got a problem with that person and you got a problem with that person, he said, you got to open yourself to the possibility it could be you.
Yeah, that's him.
And so I'm thinking that if this person is the same and he has a problem with absolutely everybody, it's definitely not personal to you.
Yeah.
And there is no failing on your part because this is how he's wired, obviously. And you can't fix it. So since you can't fix it, it's kind of like you know that it's going to rain, so you get an umbrella.
Right.
Right? Yeah. Shantideva, at some point, he says you can't cover the world with leather, so you have to put shoes on your feet.
Right, right.
And so so the one good thing is that he's not treating you any different than he's treating anybody else. And in the end, he still is only hurting himself. So if there's some way, I don't know, other people might have some similar situations they've been in and some tips and hints for this. Because you've probably tried everything, right?
Yeah. Well, the one thing that I do over and over again is I'm like, okay, I'm going to put up my boundaries. I'm not going to fall into that, like, let's get comfortable again. I'm going to keep those boundaries up. But then they start to fall away and I start to feel comfortable, still a little uneasy. And then boom, it happens again. And every time I'm like, I'm going to put up those boundaries. So I think I need to take a better look at me keeping my boundaries up and a comfortable distance.
And I understand precisely what you're talking about. And it could very well be that one of those boundaries is to imagine that you are an open window and he's in pain shouting through you.
Mm-hmm. Right. That's good. Yeah. Thank you.
He's screaming in pain. People don't act like that because they're happy.
No. No,
you know, so
you always get to the heart of the matter, Lama Kathy.
I still have stuff that makes me really angry and I have to keep working on it too. It's hard, man. It's but what's really interesting is that we know that if we can tame even one resentment, we've really done something. That's a big deal, you know. If we can even, there's always going to be those things we can't fix. I had a relative, most of you know that my dad was married 3 times and his third wife was quite a handful. She was quite a handful. And she didn't like me one bit. And at first I didn't like her one bit. But then eventually I realized that there was no way she was going to leave my dad's life. And I couldn't change his mind about her and I couldn't change her. So I just said, okay, here we go. And so I did this practice with her a lot, you know, the gifting, sending her mental gifts and things like that. But eventually I just kind of like was thinking to myself, honey, knock yourself out. You know, I just imagine her as a 2-year-old throwing herself on the floor. And that seemed to be the only thing that worked for me.
I'm trying that tomorrow. Yes.
It's like, And you can imagine him wearing like knee pants and the sailor suit with the lollipop. That's what Colbert does with the politician he doesn't like. Puts him in knee pants. Yeah. It's pretty funny. And I'll be thinking about you, you know, just keep hanging in there because you good. You have Buddha nature. So you're Buddha nature, you good. So now you have to figure out how to bring that. And you can also imagine yourself as Chenrezig made of light. So that's also a possible thing. So that will hopefully help a little bit. Thanks for sharing it. Maybe do other people have suggestions in this situation where you've done something that's worked for you? Anybody else has something to share? Okay, just checking.
No suggestions, but sympathies.
Say again.
No suggestions, but sympathies for the sympathy.
There you go. Yeah. Well, and there's another question in chat. With all the great masters that you have come in contact with, have any of them perfected the 6 virtues? Well, you know, I believe Kempo Karthi Rinpoche did it. I believe he did it. I really do, because he was always, I was talking with Lama Sultram Yeshe the other day. And by the way, if you want to have a good program, you can invite Lama Sultram Yeshe to give one of his emotional healing seminars. They're very good. They're very good. But anyway, I was talking with him yesterday about our connection with Kempo Karthi Rinpoche and how he just really exemplified for us every one of the, you know, every possible good quality that a person could have. He was generous. He was patient. He had compassion that wouldn't quit. He was, his patience was enormous. I mean, look at us. We were a little bit weird and totally not his culture. And yet he loved us like we were kids. We were his kids. And he dealt with all of our weirdness and all of our strange ideas and all of our momentary laziness about doing Dharma, you know, like, oh, I have a hangnail. I can't practice today. I mean, you know, but he dealt with all of it. So I would definitely say that Kempo Karthra Rinpoche was like as perfect a human as there have been. So I don't know if that helps, but yes. Other things to talk about. We have time for one more topic. If anybody has a topic they'd like to. Well, then, okay. So no other questions. Oh, somebody's trying to talk. I think there's a can't unmute. Oh, okay. Oh, can't unmute. Let's see if there's some way to do it.
Is this working?
Yeah. There you go.
Okay. So when you were speaking about the patience and aggression, I was thinking about some of my earlier behavior toward a person that I worked with and how bad it was and how sad I am that I never see her again, but how sad I am. And I was thinking, I would give gifts and it might make some difference because you can't really go back in time or anything like that.
Yeah.
But I really regret that. So that was one thing that I wanted to say.
I really appreciate you sharing that because I think all of us in our life have been involved in something that we don't feel good about. I think everybody has this, you know, whether it is the way we treated someone or the way we didn't pay attention to someone who needed attention. I mean, there's all kinds of ways that we've kind of failed other people, or we feel like we failed other people. You know what I mean? You can't go back in the past and make yourself smarter. And like, oh, if only I had known what I know now, I wouldn't have acted that way. And, you know, I mean, sometimes when we're young and immature, or when we don't really have spiritual values on board, these things will happen because we're stuck in the belief that it's a zero sum game. And if I win, you have to lose. You see what I'm saying? You know, where one person feels they have to win, and for them to win, somebody else has to lose. And so I do think that there are lots of ways to make amends, even in situations where actually being in contact with the person isn't possible or may actually cause harm. And I think one of the ways is to do this gift giving and say, well, you know, and also to think about yourself and say, you know, I give some gifts to myself of patience and goodness. You know, you can do a form of Tonglen, the compassion meditation, sending and receiving for yourself, who you were then, right? Okay. Yes. You know, breathe out healing to the younger you, right? And breathe in and remove that anger, and then breathe out and give yourself some healing and some understanding. It's almost like you've become like your best friend, you know, your younger self's best friend. Right. And found a way to say, well, you know, can't go back and change it, but here's some love for you, me of the past, you know, and because I feel compassion for her, me of the past, you know.
Right.
I think that helps. And then I can really understand this. And you can offer lamps at the monastery for this person and things like that, you know, and or donate to a charity in their name and things like that. And just, you know, kind of send them these gifts. But the imaginary gifts of sending them goodness is I think, a really good thing. So I understand this situation, because there have been situations where I have acted badly toward other people, and I've had to go and apologize, because it just, there was no other way. I had to go back and apologize. And so I did the ones I could do, but there's some that I'll never be able to do, because the situation is just not going to be possible. So I really thank you for sharing this, and please do have some compassion for the younger you. I mean, what can you do, right? Yeah. I can only be as smart as I am right this minute.
Right.
And I can't go back in the past and make myself smarter. You know, but I've heard many people say the same as you, which is, if I could have done it differently, I would have. You know, right. I would have if I could have. Yeah.
Yes, I think you're talking about the judging other people is what really brought that some clarity to that.
Yeah, I know. And you know, and I think what you've had to say about that is very compelling. And I think that what Wendy was talking about her situation, where, you know, she's judging this person and this person is judging her, and it's kind of like, it's a really painful situation. That I think we're in this a lot, aren't we? You know, and but I'm glad that you've had a light bulb moment, ding, you know, on this. And it's always good to have light. It's always good to have the light. Always.
You know, thank really. You.
Yeah. No. Thank you. No. Thank you for sharing. And I hope all continues to go well, and that you and that the younger you and the younger you have détente. You know, yeah. Have a little, you know.
We'll work on it this week.
I'll pray for that. Yeah. Well, because of time, we actually have to stop here. I'm sorry, I kind of went on tonight, but Shanti Deva was good. You know, it's fun to read Shanti Deva, you know, and this is by no means a complete introduction to his work. I think, as I mentioned last time, if you want to do yourself a favor, read it out loud. And I'm just reading chapter 6 out loud just now gave me all kinds of ideas for things going on in my own life. And that often amazes me, how Shanti Deva, how did you know what I'm going through right now, Shanti Deva? You know, how did you know? But I'll pray for all of us, that we can all find some more patience. So dig a little and see if we can find some more, and make aspirations to benefit beings. Someone asked what the Pema Chodron book is. It's called No Time to Lose. No Time to Lose. And it covers 9 of the 10 chapters. She doesn't cover chapter 9 in this book, but it's really amazing. And the entirety of Shanti Deva's book is in here, except for chapter 9. I shouldn't say the entirety, but all the other chapters are in here. And so it's really, and she comments on every single verse. So it's pretty cool, actually. So there's a verse in here, and I wonder if I'll be lucky to find it. Nope, not going to find it. There's a lovely verse in here where he says, and catching sight of others, know that it is through them that you will attain awakening. So look on them with open, loving hearts. That's pretty cool. And catching sight of others. And it's the continuation of a previous verse. So anyway, the verse goes, and catching sight of others, may you know that it is through them that you will attain Buddhahood. And so look on them with open, loving hearts. In other words, just seeing others in the street, know that it is through serving them, and it is through relating to them with the 6 perfect virtues that you will attain Buddhahood. And so try your best not to hate anyone. Look on them with open, loving hearts. I just love that verse. And you can type it into Google and it'll show you where it belongs.
But it's one of my favorite verses. I've taught on it several times because it just talks about the capacity that we all have to bless each other and to bring each other happiness. So thank you. Well, we'll be talking again in March, correct? I have us down for March the 10th, right?
Yeah. Okay.
Well, I thank you so sincerely. Thank you for inviting me to be here and be part of your group. And my prayer is that these times together help us to find the patience within ourselves and the goodness within ourselves and continue to work from there. I'll recite a short prayer of dedication. Through this merit, may all achieve the omniscience of Buddhahood. May it defeat our common enemy, wrongdoing, from the stormy waves of birth, old age, sickness, and death. From the ocean of samsara, may we free all beings. May we free all beings. May we free all beings. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you, Roma Cassie.
It's great to see